Shavua Tov. This week was a very difficult week in the community. We have a big community in Phoenix, Arizona. And a Bukharian Jew was arrested 3 days ago by the charges that he killed his not Jewish girlfriend, and he put her in a suitcase and he was throwing her to the dumpster next to the Jewish center. And of course then you know all the rumors and everything, but it's a certain level of that was never in our community. So I had a phone call on Thursday from the leaders of Arizona. They asked me what to do. People are panicking. Because, you know, we never heard about killers and about putting them and throwing to the dumpsters. You know, it's you don't know what to do with this. And I was thinking in our parasha, it starts in the parasha talks about Yosef HaTzadik. And I will try to link it. It says, Vayi Adonai et Yosef, Vayi ish matzliach, Vayi ved Adonai v'mitzri, that Yosef become very successful. And it ends, Vayi Yosef yefe tor v'yefe meren. Yosef was handsome, nice looking, beautiful person. And so Rashi asks a question, if somebody is handsome, he's handsome before, not after. So Rashi brings a midrash, when Yosef felt that he's on the horse, Moshe, on Chustvet Harasho, he has nice living, power, respect. כיוון שראה עצמו מושל, ברשות הרב, ברוכים הבאים. כיוון שראה עצמו מושל, when he felt good, when he felt comfortable, התחיל אוכל ושותה. מה זה אוכל ושותה? One rabbi say he start very heavy diet, one say he start to watch his diet already. What to eat, what not to eat. ושותה, maybe it's alcohol, maybe it's all kind of energizers. הוא מסלסל בשערו. And start to look about the way it looks like, the haircut, the clothing, to be like the, to look good. To look in the mode, to look in the... אמר הקדוש ברוך הוא, אביך מתאבל ואתה מסלסל בשעריך, אני מגרה בך את הדור, מיד ותישא אשת אדוני ותמיה. השם is telling you, your father is mourning, and you feeling so good, I'm going to send you Potiphar's wife. So I asked a question, with all the respect, his father is mourning, what's to do with Yosef? The mother only because of the brother, not because of yourself. Why? מה זה אביך מתאבל? Give me a good answer.
You can tell him I'm alive.
לא, אסור לדבר.
מה זה אסור לדבר?
היה להם, I told you last week, יעקב is telling to Laban, 20 years, I miss my father. אמר לו לבן ליעקב, חי, נחשף נחשפת, חלוש שלם, בואו, בואו נדעת רוב. He met with his son, does he go to his father?
No.
Another 2 years he's going in Israel. So why don't we go to Israel and say the father Shalom? He goes to Yerushalayim, goes to Betel, he goes to Megidal Eder. Go home, say to your father Shalom. He says last week, parasha, כך שים לב. He says like this. יעקב was born, בנג'מין was born, אחר כך היו בני יעקב 12, ובן שמעון לוי יהודה וזבולון, ויבוא יעקב אל יצחק אביו, אבא, the mission accomplished. בסדר? His father told him, you come with 12 boys, that's all. No 12 boys, you are not here. Hashem, his father telling to Yosef, Yosef, you're going to make peace between you and your brothers. Even when Yosef was a king, by the age of 30, does he call his father? He has to wait another 9 years. Not now in his slavery. At the age of 39 or 38, Yosef is calling to his father and saying, come. Why wait so many years? Why to me? Hashem told, Yaakov told to Yosef, my son, you have to make peace. No peace, no home. Don't call me. עכשיו, מה זה אביך מתאבל ואתה מזלזל בשערותיך? אז אמרתי, אביך מתאבל זה הקדוש ברוך הוא, זה לא רק זה. מה, what is the question? There is, what I was referring to what happened this, the homicide in Arizona in this Tuesday, is that we came to America, ברוך השם, we feel comfortable. We make a nice living, nice house, kids, ברוך השם, לא חסר כלום. Now the question is, why did we do it? Most of the people who came to America and they got the refugee status was because they want to serve God better. Mm-hmm. And they cannot do it under the communist regime. So you came to America, oh Hashem, you have everything, just serve Hashem. So now he wants to feel good, then he wants to go to here, Atlantic City, Las Vegas, Hollywood, drugs, alcohol, gambling, just name it. This is the reason I came to America? So the idea is over here that people are getting, they came to America, Hashem is giving us, and then people get to get, they're just losing it. And they start all kind of theories, all kind of nonsense, couple came to see me last Wednesday. They are married 8 months. No, 9 months. Thank God she was pregnant after 1 month. That shows she is 8 months pregnant. They come to me to divorce. I said, wait a minute, let's first take the picture from the... Let your parents pay the bills for the whole, then divorce. No, you get. Let's wait until the baby is going to come. No juice. How she told me, the girl, it's better now than later. Amarti, you start already, you become a prophet already, so become later, now, today. And they lost, totally lost. Every small problem, okay, let's divorce, let's this. It's become like even horses you buy in a slower rate than this. Every small argument, finish. So, HaKadosh Baruch Hu tell to yourself, I'm sending you to Egypt, I take care of you, don't forget why you are there. And this is the combination of what happened there, what's happening today in our parasha. But it's just a small thing, I would like to discuss something else in the parasha. With your permission, we're going to Yaakov HaTzadik and learn something from him, because we are his descendant. Remember, the brothers and Yosef are start to fight. Nachon?
Yes.
Yosef is telling slander, the brother won't, they hate each other. And everybody is asking what Yaakov is doing. The father has to call them and say, sit over here. Dileton chol kuneton, shigaf, tkigar chi. They're arguing, umar kacha, Yosef. Yosef is blaming them, they are blaming him, this, that, what? Letters, this thing, you know what I mean? So, call them, we say in Russian, Krugli store, and say, what do you want? Kigar shit. What the Torah is telling us? The Torah is telling this. Vayikan ubo echav, the brothers are jealousy, ve'aviv shamar et hadavar. Ma'a shamar et hadavar? Omer Rashi, haya mamtin ve'metzep pe'edam. Doesn't talk. Is it good thing or bad thing?
It could be good and bad.
You can be a politician right there, like good or bad?
Depends.
Yaakov decided, done. Be quiet. Rashi, his waiting until it's going to happen.
What's gonna happen? What's gonna happen?
You see, the beauty was that the dream goes by the interpretation. When he tells the dreams to his brother, they say, "Are you going to be our king?" It means they made a translation, they interpret themselves to the right direction. So it's ready in heaven, and they make his opponents, they say, "Hey, you should put your spaka rosh to it." It means they made the dream
reality.
And after I was watching this, I went back few pages before. There was a very sad case when Yaakov's daughter was attacked physically, mentally, emotionally by Shechem ben Hamor. And what was the reaction of the brothers? Let's kill them.
Yeah.
What Yaakov says, Yaakov shama, and Yaakov heard it, v'chirish Yaakov ad bua, and he was silent until they came. Why Yaakov is silent?
It's not his mission.
You know, after the brothers they killed, they come to him. So Yaakov is telling, "Why are you doing all this?" So he told him, "We don't want to listen to you. They wanted to undermine our family. We did it." And Yaakov was not happy with them. You see the way that when he dies, the way he talks to them, to Shimon and Levi, he watched them left and right. So I was thinking, when Yaakov got this behavior of just being quiet? Where? From where?
His wife.
After his son.
I hear a hint of his own. Why is it his wife? She was quiet. I think that he learned it from an event that took place. Yaakov had a wonderful experience in his life from the age of 0 to 63 with a very interesting brother, Esau. And then another 20 years with another father-in-law. Both of them very interesting characters. But something was sure for them. What was their problem? You know, Reuben? Listen, Reuben. Yaakov Avinu didn't speak to Lavan the whole 20 years. Whatever Lavan says, Shekishmogwe. Whatever you say. After 20 years, Yaakov decided once in his life to explain to Lavan what he's coming for. And he's telling him, 20 years I was in your house. I worked 14 years and then 6 years. You changed my salary 10 times. And if Hashem didn't help me, you're going to kill me just get rid of me. And he's telling him, and I saw, and you abused me, and you did me, and he's talking. He make a whole speech. We say in Bukharian, Yad Dilash Cholik, he just empty. Whatever is in his heart is empty. Now he wants to hear the reaction. His uncle, his father-in-law, his friend, the one who gave him the ability to be, as a Lavan is looking at him, he say, Chai. Then Lavan says, "Konshili, you're finished. Now listen to me, Sinod. Your daughters are mine. Your wives are mine. Your wives are mine. Your sheep are mine. Your money is mine. Whatever you see over here, it's mine." Tini shivoni deal with it. It's empty with the kibbutz. Now tell me, what is the reaction after 20 years? After 20 years, he's telling him, you spoke, chai, bogi b'chudash. Akol sheli, everything is mine. Ma perush? People, the majority of people, especially this kind of people, talking to them doesn't mean anything. Why? Because they don't want to listen. When you don't want to listen, you don't listen.
So you don't talk when you...
Huh?
So you don't talk. When you feel like somebody doesn't want to hear you.
You know my famous joke? In Israel, when the Kala is getting married, they take her to the Stena Plashe to pray. So they get used to speak to the wall after the wedding. First it's Rabbi Devolgar Zena, first it's like. This is the talking has a very limited power on people. What can change people? First thing, if they will to change. If not, don't waste your time. Me and my wife, we were reading a very interesting article. We were talking about it, and I think to connect it today, something to learn from Yaakov Avinu. Husband and wife, they wrote a letter to a psychologist. And the letter say like this. We are an amazing couple. We love each other. We have children, we have everything, but we, all of us, we don't know how to deal with stress. And every day, there is a fight in the house. And so we fight, and then we calm down, and then another fight. And we want you to give us an advice, what to do, not to be so angry in the house. That's all, nothing to do with you, it's about them. Oh, Hashem, your house has no pressure, no pressure, they handle it, Hashem.
Stress
is
between them, or because of one another, or because of the children?
They call it, they say both of them, they're living in Sir Lachatz, they're living in, he's stressed from work, she's stressed from school, she's a teacher, and and they have children, so morning rush hour, afternoon rush hour, evening, and when evening at 8 o'clock, when all the house is quiet, they start to argue between themselves. Mm-hmm. And they say, we don't know how to deal with stress, and it's become anger. And they want $1 million answer.
Mm-hmm.
Ruben Omer, learn from me, go to that film.
Valerianka.
Valerianka. Valka, she's practical. So, the psychologist tried to say something which I believe is very important and it's very basic, and it's not something which is great news, but it's something which is, I think, and can apply to us too. He said that stress and anger, they are cousins, but they are not identical brothers. Stress and anger, it's not something that it doesn't have to go together. But before I'll go to elaborate, I'm going to teach you something. There are people who they have a lot of anger, but they know how to play the anger, so they don't look angry. It's called the hidden anger. They don't scream, don't yell, but zarashon mezana, but they give their poison. It's not anger. This is a very tight, difficult type, because when you ask him, you say, I'm not an angry person, and she wants to say, it's very difficult to fix, because the anger is hidden. And this suggested that there is about 7 different ways to take anger out without screaming. First of all, he called it they become very judgmental. He doesn't tell to his wife that he's upset at her. He just tells her, hey, she's very lazy, she's crazy. He puts labels on or she put labels on him, or the woman. I'm not angry. But they put labels. It's called prejudgment. But inside, he's boiling. But outside, he's very quiet, but he's Zara Shemezan. Another way is to, it doesn't show emotions. The world, nothing. And he let the other side, the other person, he retaliate through this. Let's say his wife, she fixed the house and everything. After John Doria, he's making it, he doesn't say nothing bad, but he just ignores his feelings. And sometimes when husband and wife don't know how to show feelings, they can kill each other nicely. One of my students told me, I give her the money, it's enough. I don't want to listen about it. I told him, you cannot talk like this, because not just the money. No, my wife. I said, no. It's very difficult, it's very dangerous, because if you don't give to each other emotional support, it won't work. Especially not in America, when everybody's independent. Number three is to have contest with the who is better. I have a couple in my community. The husband, he comes every day home after work. I can say it, he helped his wife 1 hour to fix the house. Uh-huh. And then they fight. So I say, if you help, why you fight? So he said, then he tells her, Tismatrikakti, no. Tismatrikakti, kak you are not.
Okay.
You are not functional. At lomet of kedet. So he is doing the help. But he has to put the salt inside the heart, and they say, "Mustop lachodil." So I say, "You want me not to say anything too?" I said, "Don't do anything. If you're doing just to help, don't do it." So he's angry, but he showed it in this way. Another way is that. By both of them, they're fighting each other. The reason I came late tonight, a couple came to me, Baruch Hashem, they married for 1 year, they come to say hello, and every 2 weeks she's threatening him. If you don't do this, I'll do this. At a certain point, they come tired of what says, so why fight and you just go if you want to go. So then they come to me, take 1 hour of my time. So, he's angry, she's angry, so they're threatening. I don't give you this, I don't give this, I don't give this. And all these ultimatums and all these things, it's an anger that goes out in this direction. It's very difficult to deal with this anger. Why? But you ask him, you say, I'm not an angry person, I'm just reacting. And this is a big trap. But let's say we are talking about other things. Let's talk about people that are really getting angry. What makes a person angry?
Yeah.
Ruben talk about ego. Ego is the father of everything. Yes, I call the ego. But what really makes a person to feel angry? When you make somebody, your husband, your wife, your friend, huh?
Something that they don't
want to
hear.
Huh? Jealousy. I think it starts with jealousy. All the anger issue starts with jealousy.
Jealousy, it's... I think they're cousins, all of them. But I believe that... I will ask you, let me ask differently. Somebody is stressed out. Quiet, quiet, quiet. Suddenly, it starts.
Boiling.
The boiling. What makes the boiling? He's stressed. He's not. I had a few months ago, somebody came to my office in the morning and said, Rabbi Yeshua, I have a business, I have this, but I don't have cash flow, I don't know what to do, I cannot sleep at night. Then he left, somebody came and said, Rabbi, I don't have money to pay the bills. And everybody is crying. I said, what is the money? The number, not to cry. He has a lot, he's crying, he doesn't have his crying. So, very stressed out. But what is the point that the stress becomes? That you start
missing
to really lose it.
Huh? You're missing something.
Unsecure.
What?
Whatever, everybody's missing something else. Some who is missing
something. Oh, spirituality. No, I'm asking you, let's say you woke up in the morning, there is no food, and you, it doesn't make you upset on the spot. What really makes the boiling thing? Huh?
Consistent of the same thing, the same
Roma touched a very, very, very true point. Because sometimes it's once, twice, after a certain point when it's become pain already, when you...
Expectations.
Huh?
Expectations.
It is the beginning. But let's say they make the same mistake once, twice, three, four times. Then after a few times, he's ready for the next time to explode. But it has to be, it's something that has been, is adding, it's been...
Because you can't solve the problem?
What?
Because you can't solve the problem?
Because he never tried to solve the problem. Because for him, for this person, the fact that this problem happens, it's a justification of reaction. Am I clear? Am I clear? I will give you an example. We had a couple that lived in Israel. He is American and she is Israeli. Say that? She thinks that the Americans are not smart, this is a nice way to say it. And she thinks that she is wild and brutal. Yeah. They live together. But he put in his mind שהישראלים הם סתם כעסנים ורגזנים ובלי שום דרך ארץ, והיא חושבת שהאמריקאים זה לא חכמים במיוחד. And this is in the system. And then they start to go out. And they, whenever she used to say something mean to him, he said, בואו נגש מרח את זה. And it's been piling up, and one day he really answered her. He said, you and the family and Mishparach Avotem. And then when she asked him something, and he didn't ask what she wanted to do, so he said, you are nothing, you are low life, and he used to fight all the time on this. So when they come to counseling to the rabbi to ask him what to do, how to overcome cultures, the first thing was, not to be prejudgmental and don't start with this kind of low thing. in order to touch this, how to give you a certain tool to learn with this, there is a concept, it's called ETER, and I will explain. What is our understanding about people angry? Somebody made him angry, and he, as a result, it's a reaction to an action. It's like two things. He did something and I answer him. According to the modern psychology, what they try to model, they're saying, it doesn't go like this. There are not two stages, there are four stages. There is no event and reaction. It's called the event, translation or transmission, emotion and reaction. And I will explain. There is a woman, she is standing in the middle of the street. Suddenly somebody comes and touches her skirt. She's turned her back. And she sees that it's her child. So she's smiling to him. The touching, somebody was pushing the didn't make her upset yet. She had to go to three, say, first she has to know who is doing it. Then she has to check her emotions. Then she reacts. So she saw it was her child. So she's not threatened anymore. And because he's her child and she loves him, she reacts with a smile. So it's not just an event and reaction, it's more a series of events. There is event, there is the way that you translate to yourself what happened, then you have to choose your emotion, then you react. If you're going to work on this too, it's a lot to do with your translation and your emotion to make the reaction. Meaning, according to this way, you are not being upset by your spouse or by your friend. You decided to be upset. It's your decision. It's not his. What do we say? We don't get upset. People make me upset. It's not true. If you didn't decide to be upset, you will never be upset. And if you can escape and say, no, it was a reaction, I was under attack. No. it's your reaction. A rabbi that was a few years ago was making a big campaign against me. He came to see me and he said, Rabbi, thank you for teaching me how to behave when you are under attack. I'm learning from you. I learned from you how to behave. No, I like the idea because this is the bottom line. We think, and I'm going to touch it to the next level, we think that to give in is your weakness.
So, weakness.
Weakness. I'm going to show you. In Judaism, especially in Yaakov Avinu Alav HaShalom, we learn that giving in is a point of strength. When you are going to evaluate a person, the highest, in our culture at least, is and say, oh, the Mibazmin. He's very, you cannot easily hurt him. In our understanding, and you are in a war, and you are in a defense, and you are in superiority complexes, and all kinds of nonsense that we have and self-esteem, we take it and we defend ourselves. Yaakov Avinu is teaching us that to be strong is to give in sometimes. To retaliate is a very high level. In order to retaliate Lashem Shamayim in the Torah, it's very difficult to come to this point. Special. And, husband and wife are husband and wife, brothers, children, has to be all the time by giving in, you have been lifting up. There was a big rabbi in Eretz Israel, Rabbi Aryeh Levin. He was a poor man. And when he got married, he came home. He didn't need even to give a wife a wedding gift. So he thought, I'm going to give you a gift of giving in. I will never fight with you.
The best gift.
And they lived together for 70 years. And what was the reward? Rav Eliashiv was her son-in-law. Because giving in Judaism, is never a source of weakness. It's a source of strength. In the jungle, it doesn't go like this. When you go to the real world, in the jungle, if you're going to give in, you're going to be eaten up. Just Boris told me, I hope it's not true that a big company in 47 make a chapter 7, 20 million, and I said, I hope it's not true. don't ask after the show, no, really. After the show, don't get so excited. So it's a war, but it has come to husband and wife. come to friends, come to family, over here it's not a war. It's not a zoo. It's a family. And family is sacred, is not less than a synagogue. So, when a husband and wife, they give in to each other, it's not because they are weaker, because they are pure. Mm-hmm. I say to everybody all the time, you know, two husband and wife are fighting. Who should be the first one to give in? The smarter one. Mm-hmm. So, you know, if you are smarter, see if you give in. But in our understanding, I'll show him, I'll show her. Yaakov Avinu is the Abrazetz. Yaakov Avinu is a model of a person with strength, but not, he's not, he doesn't put it inside like his anger. He just decided, I'll give in for the sake of this. The sake of the family, children. What are you gaining when there is, in the house, there are no arguments? The kids are much normal. There is no behavior problems. The house is, the quiet of the house and between the parents, it makes, it's a best prescription for a normal family. And don't undermine it. This is the, this is what we have now, the old problem that you have in our community, in America together, that it's become like a zoo, not a family. So, Yaakov is teaching us that in order to build Beit Israel, you need tons of patience, and you give in as a source of your strength. Hi, Lachim. Hi, Lach. My Lach. And then you really show that you really